it's never just to how you've been or what you've been doing tonight. It's never just a now and then, just checking in, are you alright? It's I miss you, I need you, I wanna come over. It's a 2 a.m. I'm alone, and I've had enough. I ain't picking up my phone, 'cause a call, it's never just a call.
Barrett Baber's song, Never Just a Call. He was a contestant and runner-up on season 9 of NBC's The Voice. And you can purchase his latest album, A Room Full of Fighters, wherever you buy your music. Or more importantly, you can see him at Blacklake Golf Resort in Nipomo on September the 3rd as part of the 805 Country Music Festival, which will also feature Johnny Owens and his tribute to his late father, country music legend and TV star Buck Owens, and local favorites J.D. Hardy and Noach, Tangeras. Tickets are available on Event Brite, and if you buy them before September 1st, you could get upgraded to VIP status at the event. Just search 805 Country Music Festival on Event Brite. In this podcast interview with Barrett Baber, we'll talk about how The Voice changed his life, how hard it is to become a star in country music, and what it's like to juggle a very young family while getting hit with an onslaught of success after being thrust into the limelight on America's number one reality TV singing competition. But first, we asked him, what was the most significant change you noticed right away after The Voice?
Well, I tell you, man, I'd like to say that my life was boring and nothing was happening, and I was sitting around the house waiting on the phone to ring before The Voice, but that's not the case with two toddlers. You know, my son now is 5 and my daughter's 3. Back then they were 3 and 1, and so I was living a pretty crazy life, getting up in the middle of the night, changing diapers, and honestly, man, living the dream. I was really, I've always been content and happy to just be a good dad and a good father and work hard and do things in a way that kind of change people's lives and affect people. And that's why I was, you know, so passionate about my job as a high school teacher, you know, being able to go in and at the time and work with kids, work with teenagers, and you know, really loved what I had going on. I was simultaneously writing and playing shows and doing a lot of acoustic work for next to nothing, you know, no money. And music has always been a huge part of my life and was then. And now the biggest difference is I still do all those things as a dad and a husband. And now my job is just different. You know, I get up every day and write and then I go out on, you know, for sometimes 2 weeks at a time and play shows for people all over the country and play the full half at some of these bars. A great deal in that regard. And moved over here to Tennessee, meetings and that kind of thing. And still grinding hard. Catalyst for me to move on down the road and really get closer to becoming a real viable country artist, that has sustainability. And that was a great thing. But really, there's a whole lot of work to still be done when you get off The Voice. There's tons of shows to be played, tons of fans to be made, and records to be made too. So my life was crazy before. It's even crazier now, and it's got a lot to do with being on The Voice.
Garth Brooks being 100%. What percent do you feel you're there to Garth Brooks level? I mean, you know, like in this journey that it is tough to become a country artist. That is successful and paying the bills. I mean, you live in Nashville. You know this. You know, I mean, like, how far are you in where you want to be?
I tell you, man, I feel like I'm 75% there. Good. In regards to the music I'm making, the opportunities that are coming my way, the songs that I'm writing, the records that I'm making, 75% there. But the funny part is, and the frustrating part is about this business is that last 25% is the hardest to achieve. It's hard to get to where I am. You know, I'd say it's the easy part is the first 50%. The next 25% is even harder. And then now going all the way to the promised land, you know, getting to a place where you are selling out arenas and you're selling out stadiums and you're selling millions of records. That's the next step. And that's really the detail part of it, where you get into making little moves with your sound and with your band and with your personnel and your team. And, you know, all those little decisions that you have to make, it's really what nudges you a percent or two up every time. So I think I'm I'm closer to that than I've ever been, but also recognize that that I can't be complacent, and there's a whole lot more work to do. And part of that is getting out on the road, like Garth did, like Blake did, like all the like Eric Church did, you know, for so many years, playing hundreds of shows for sometimes not that many people, building up a really faithful groundswell of support out there, and earning it. It's not given, it's not guaranteed, it's earned. And that's where I have a whole lot of hope in getting all the way there, is because I've never been one who's afraid to do that. I'm not looking for shortcuts. I wasn't when I did the show, and I'm not now. So that's why I'm out on the road. That's why I'm out, you know, thousands of miles away from home, getting ready to play shows in California and all over the country, because I recognize that there's work to be done, and that work can't be skipped. You can't substitute that for anything else.
You ever surf, Barrett?
No.
Are you going to say? I know you're playing.
You know what? I tried once. I was in, where was I? I was in Costa Rica for a week, and I tried, but it was more, there was a lot of effort. That's yes. A difficult thing to achieve. That may be harder, it may be harder to learn how to surf than it is to become a star.
Well, see, you talk about the last bit being the hardest part to achieve. When you surf, it's easy. Like, I took surfing lessons, and, I had an instructor, and he would tell me, okay, I'm going to push you out, and then all you got to do is stand up on the board. But then when you have to paddle into your own waves, and then you have to give that little bit extra as your arms are getting tired to make sure that you get into that wave and catch that wave and then stand up. That's the last 20-25% that you speak of in the world of surfing. I know you're playing Huntington Beach the night before you show up here in Nipomo. Are any plans to get on the board? It's going to be hot. It's going to be hot here.
I got a lot of plans to watch some people in awe of how good they are at that. But the last thing I think I need to do is get out there. I'm concerned about my brand image. The last thing I need to do is get out there with my shirt off, big old country bumpkin trying to surf, and especially around a bunch of people that are good at it. But, I tell you what, I will certainly be in awe of the ones that can do it, man. And that's how I feel, honestly, about people like Garth Brooks and, you know, the people that have made it all the way. I recognize now, because I'm doing it myself, how difficult that is, how there's so much hard work involved, and there's a little bit of luck. You know, you got to catch the right wave. The right wave has to come. The timing has to be right. There's so many things involved in it. So, you know, I'm in awe of people that can get out there and shred on a surfboard, but just as much as I am in awe of the ones that are out there really doing this thing at a super high level.
What does your wife think about the timing of the kids and this career change? That, I mean, here you were a teacher for so long, and that's probably what you were banking on being, and then all of a sudden the voice comes along. I don't want to say instant superstardom, but a faster track to superstardom, doing what you love to do. But then again, also being away for weeks at a time, not there to kind of help out with the kids. I have two toddlers in the same age range. One is about to turn one, and the other one is four. And I know that as a result of having the toddlers, my workload increased, because you want to make sure you have a foundation for them financially in the future. But still, there is some stress at home because of that, because you're now spending more time working to make sure that it's stressful for anybody who has kids, but to be out of the house, I couldn't imagine what that's like.
Yeah, you nailed it, man. I mean, it's definitely a challenge, but I will say this, that it takes a very, very special woman to be married to a musician, especially one that hasn't made it all the way, you know, to the top. It's it takes a special woman who really gets what this is. And I've said this a lot of times in interviews, and keep going back to it because it's so true. It's me being a musician and pursuing music as my career now. You know, it's really a part of my DNA. It's it's about who I am and not about what I do. And Sarah, you know, from the very beginning, you know, this has been 15, almost 20-year run of me writing songs and playing little shows here and there and sort of having this nugget of a dream in my head for many years. And she's been a part of that now for almost 10. It'll be 10 years in November. And so she kind of knew when she got into this thing what she was getting into, which is an artist, a guy who, regardless of what his job is, how he pays the bills, is an artist and is a writer, and all the good and bad things that come with that. When she vowed to be my wife forever, she accepted those things, and I've been so blessed to have her on my team and really accept me for who I am and recognize that there's a lot of ups and downs in this business, and part of that requires a lot of sacrifice on her part, of her free time and effort when I'm not there. But she also knows that if I'm not out here chasing my thing, if I'm not making music, if I'm not doing something that I care about, then I'm not going to be the best me. And I think that's what, she wants for me, is to be the best me, because she knows the best me is the best dad, is the best husband, is the best singer, is the best songwriter, is the best artist. So I've been immensely fortunate to have her on my squad, and she's been great about it, never complains. Does what she has to do. And then also when I get home, when I am home, I'm really cognizant to try to make the absolute most of every second that I'm there. It's quality time, not quantity. Sometimes it's just the quality of time that I get to spend with my kids and my wife. So, it's been a good thing, man. It's been a transition for sure over the last year and a half, but more than anything, it's been a great run for us, and we're seeing our dreams come true. And I firmly believe we're going to see them continue to develop and come true, and that would be a great thing for me to give that gift to her, to allow her to kind of know that she's a part of that, of making something really special happen. This is a thing that we're making happen together for us, not me making happen for myself.
See, that's the cool thing about podcast is you can download this to your phone and say, listen to what I said about you next time you guys get in an argument or something. So all these nice things that's I said right. From about the 11-minute mark to about the 13-minute mark, this is all about you, Sarah.
That's right, man.
Blacklake Golf Resort, you're going to be playing with Buck Owens' son doing a tribute to his father. Who were some traditional country influences? And when I say traditional, I'm going to ask you to go pre-Travis Tritt on your life.
Okay. I've got to say that without a question, Glenn Campbell played a big role in sort of the way that I perform. Conway Twitty, an old Arkansas boy that I was blessed to be able to cover and do one of his songs on The Voice, rearrange and come up with a cool arrangement. That was a big song for me on The Voice. People like that. But I also go back to not even country artists. We talk about acts like The Band and Levon Helm and James Taylor and, some of those really song-driven songwriters that are just so great that influenced me in my journey, into country music, but certainly just into the craft of making music. And those are ones that have influenced me. I think people will hear, especially, The Band and that what that is, that sort of southern rock, swampy country, but not country all the way kind of thing, man, is really the sound that I encapsulate now. And it's a sound that's coming back to country radio that people are loving, and with artists like Chris Stapleton and, Drake White, and that soulful, really soulful country, well-written songs with big, powerful melodies. And I'm proud to be one of the people that gets to make that kind of music.
Yeah, it's a cool thing to see coming back around again. And it's funny you bring up geography, because you can't escape. Like, I'm from the Pacific Northwest and I moved to California, and it wasn't until I moved away from what my musical upbringing was to another area and realize what's important to another area. So much is always made of format in the world of music, but geography has just as much influence on the type of music that you are exposed to as a kid growing up.
Yeah, there's no question about it. And I certainly am a product of that. I grew up right in eastern Arkansas in the Delta, not too far, terribly far from where Levon Helm grew up, and there in West Memphis, right across the river from Memphis, Tennessee. And I think that still plays a massive role in my sound and in the soulfulness of my voice. You know, running across the river to Memphis, Tennessee when I was much too young to be going over there, staying out all night and listening to music and street performers and, you know, the blues and R&B and all the things that aren't Memphis are sort of still inside my heart. And that's why it's, you know, you get the sound that you get, this country, soulful, swampy thing, man. Mm-hmm. That is great country music. That is great soul. It's all blended together, and it turned out great on the record. And I'm excited to bring it over there to California, man, and play the show there in Nipomo.
Blake Shelton says that you have a unique voice for country. That there's no other voice like yours in country music. People need to show up and see that in person at the Blacklake Golf Resort on Sunday the 3rd. How does that feel to have Blake Shelton say that about your art?
It's a surreal thing, man, to hear a living legend, a guy that's functioning at the absolute highest level of success, you know, say something special about you. And it also goes to prove that regardless of how good you are or how successful you are at your job, or, you know, we're all just people and we can all be moved by something special. And I think my run on The Voice was definitely a special thing. It was a moment in time that really I was able to capture and take advantage of. And so, you know, I think it just goes to show you that regardless of how good you are at something or how famous you are, we're all just human beings. And so when I hear, it means as much to me when I hear Blake say it as it does when I hear a little old lady at one of my shows tell me how much she appreciates what I do. It's what we all crave when we're writing songs, when we're making records. We don't do this necessarily to self-serve. I mean, if there's a self-serving element in all of it, because it's who you are, you know, you're just going to create stuff. But that is the payoff, man. That's the better payoff than any money or any number of fans that come to the show, is when somebody says, hey, man, I really love this song, and this really affected me, this touched me, this moved me. And so it's special coming from Blake Shelton, too, because you're talking about a guy who really knows what he's talking about because he's been doing it for so long.
Well, run out there and get the album. It's Room Full of Fighters. Great CD. Or I know when you debuted on iTunes, you were in the top 10 downloads. So congratulations on that with Room Full of Fighters. And you know, people,
I appreciate that, man. That's something to be proud of, and I am. It's a very difficult thing to promote and have a record succeed independently without any major label or major money behind it. It's all about the music and all about the fans. And so I think that says a lot about the people's connection to me as an artist and the songs, especially too, that it continues to do well and people still love it.
Central Coast is excited for you to show up, and they're going to welcome you with open arms out at the Blacklake Golf Resort on Sunday. Okay.
Let's do it, man. Can't wait. See y'all there.
All right. Thanks a lot, Barrett.
All right, brother.
There's a guy that you can't help but root for. Barrett Baber performing at Blacklake on the Sunday before Labor Day as part of the 805 Country Music Festival. Check out more tracks from Barrett Baber's A Room Full of Fighters wherever you buy music. Thank you for listening to this podcast. Find out more about Central Coast Lifestyle and many, many other interviews by subscribing to Jeff and Jeremy on iTunes, Podbean, or wherever you find podcasts. Call. It's never just a call.